remember when I was a child living in New York, my father would pick me up and put me on top of his shoulders and run me around the apartment. And I remember as he would do this, I would grab hold of his beard and I would hold on for dear life. And when I think back to this, I know it must have been excruciatingly painful for him. Yet in those moments, I just knew that my father loved me. The Bible describes God as three co-eternal persons. There's God the Holy Spirit, God the Son, and then there's God the Father. Did you know that God is the eternal Father? And I can already hear you saying to me, how can I relate to God as Father? My father was never around, or my father was abusive, or my father abandoned me when I was a child, or I don't even know who my father is. Please hear me. If that is you, God says to you today, no, I am not your earthly father. I am your heavenly father. And when the Bible describes what your heavenly father is like, it says in 1 John 4:8, God is love. He loved you so much that the Bible says in John 3:16 that God gave his only son, that if you believe in him, you will have eternal life. He's your eternally loving father, and he will neither abandon, abuse, or leave you. He says to you today,
when I lived in Japan, I had a friend who was an artist. She painted beautiful, intricate designs on silk fabric that were used to make kimonos. She invited me to her studio, and when I walked in, I saw this long table in the middle of this room. And on this table was about 10 to 12 yards of silk fabric. The work that she would do was so detailed, so intricate, but yet so amazingly beautiful. She would take her time, and sometimes it would take her 6 months to finish a 10-yard panel. I visited her one day, but she was doing something very interesting. With a magnifying glass in hand, she was going over every single inch of that fabric, checking her work to make sure that everything was good. It took her a long time because she did it slowly and carefully. And then she put down the magnifying glass, and with a smile of satisfaction on her face, she said, "It is good." The Bible tells us that God created this world and all living things in 6 days, and he rested after he was finished because all was good.
Join us in our opening hymn number 487. The words will be on the screen or in your hymnal in the garden. Thank you. melody that he gave to me within my heart is ringing. And he walks with me and he talks with me and he tells me I am his own. And the joy we share as we tarry there, none other has ever known. I'd stay in the garden with him, though the night around me be falling, but he bids me go. Through the voice of woe, his voice to me is calling. And he walks with me, and he talks with me, and he tells me I am his own. And the joy we share as we tarry there, none other has ever known. Amen. Amen. It's a great thought, isn't it? You think about God walking with Adam and Eve in the Garden of Eden, but he walks with us too, right? Walks with us every day. Our scripture this morning is Psalm 150, the culmination, the last psalm of written, and it focuses on praise to the Lord. It says, praise the Lord. Praise God in his sanctuary. Praise him in his mighty firmament. Praise him for his mighty acts. Praise him according to his excellent greatness. Praise him with the sound of the trumpet. Praise him with the lute and harp. Praise him with the timbrel and dance. Praise him with stringed instruments and flutes. Praise him with loud cymbals. Praise him with high-sounding cymbals. Let everything that has breath praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. Let's pray. Father, we thank you so much for being with us today, and we do praise your name this morning for all that you do for us each moment of each day, because we know and acknowledge that it is only by your power that everything continues to move. The world naturally is in a state of decay, and only by your grace do we continue on. And so we just praise your name for everything, and we praise you that you're with us today. May we praise you with every breath that we breathe, I pray in Jesus' name. Amen.
Children, please come up. You're welcome to sit with these rather larger children sitting here. Good morning. Oh, thank you for joining us. Thank you. This morning's story is going to be a little different. You're going to use your imagination. And actually, it harkens back to the time when you heard, tune in next week for the conclusion. Okay. It's called, I Was Not Guilty. As his father said goodnight to Samuel, he asked him why he looked so unhappy. Well, something kind of happened today at school, Samuel said. Sometimes words get stuck inside and you need someone to help pull them out. But you don't want to ask them to help pull them out because it feels much better if they do it on their own. Samuel wished his dad would do that now. Sammy, his dad said, I want you to take a deep breath and when you let it out, just say what's upsetting you. Take your time. I'll wait. Yes, Sammy said to himself. That's just the pull I needed. He took a deep breath, and as he let it out, he said, My teacher, Miss Sharna, thought I was telling Jason the answers on our test, but I was just telling him not to worry, to just remember all the studying we'd done. His father remembered the many nights Samuel spent helping his friend understand the mysterious world of numbers, telling Jordan that the numbers need your full attention in order to get the right answers. Did you tell your teacher what you were really doing? Yeah, I told her, but she didn't believe me, Dad. She gave Jason and me an F, and we have to stay after school next week. It's not fair. I don't cheat, and I didn't do anything wrong. Can you tell Miss Sharna she's the one who's wrong? Maybe she'll listen to you, because you're a grown-up. Well, son, let's think about this a minute. Uh-oh, thought Samuel. Whenever his dad said, let's think about something, it meant the answer wouldn't be a quick yes or no. Sammy, was it okay to talk during a test? No. No talking when we're taking a test. But, Dad, this was different. I wasn't giving away answers. I was trying to encourage Jason. I understand why you did it, but you also broke your teacher's rule. No talking means no talking for any reason. Couldn't you have encouraged Jason before the test? Well, yeah, I guess so, Sammy admitted. But I just wish there was a way for Miss Sharna to know the truth. I want her to know that I wasn't cheating. I know you do, Sam. Why don't we give it to Jesus before you go to sleep? The boy climbed out of bed, and he and his father knelt down side by side, holding each other's hands and bowing their heads. Dear Jesus, Sammy began, I guess I was wrong to talk in class today, but Miss Sharna's wrong too. Please tell her, Jesus, that she's punishing Jason and me for something we didn't do. I wish there was a machine or something that would be able to tell people if someone did a bad thing or not. Anyway, bless Miss Sharna and Mom and Dad and all my friends and family. Bless all the children all over the world. In Jesus' name, amen. After hugging his father goodnight, Samuel crawled back into bed, and with the day's happening swirling around inside his head, he was soon asleep and dreaming. Samuel went next door to visit with Dr. Bumpers. He wasn't the kind of doctor that looked in your ears or said, stick out your tongue and say, ah. He was a doctor of computer science. He'd gone to school for many, many years. Sammy learned a lot about computer programs and apps and viruses. They'd even played some games that Dr. Bumpers invented, games that weren't even in the stores yet. Hello there, Sammy. How are you doing today? Sammy told him what he'd shared with his father about the encouraging words, the accusation of cheating, and the punishment. Sammy even repeated his idea of inventing a machine that could fairly judge people. Dr. Bumpers raised his bushy eyebrows and announced, Sammy, I think we might have a project here. With a twinkle in his eye, Dr. Bumpers led Samuel to the little shed behind the garage and produced a set of keys. His fingers found the right one that opened the padlock on the door. He invited the boy to come inside. Sammy went in and froze in his steps. He couldn't believe what his eyes were seeing. There in the middle of the room stood a shiny silver robot. Wow! Does it do anything? Sammy asked. Not yet, the doctor said. It's just an empty box right now. I need to program it first. I was thinking about your machine that would be a fair judge. What do you think? Yes, said Sammy. Can it have a lie detector too? Certainly, Dr. Bumpers replied. I think I know exactly what to do, said Sammy. Let's program it with the Ten Commandments. Those were God's laws, so we know that they're fair, right? Sounds like a good plan, but we're going to have to find out next week how this works. Programming a machine with the Lord's Ten Commandments and a lie detector to judge. Well, You're interested too. Okay. Oh, you know, don't tell. I haven't written it yet, so I don't know how you know. Let's say a prayer. Can we ask Jesus to help us? Oh, Jesus, we love you and we know you love us too. Please help us to tell the truth all the time, Lord. And when we're falsely accused, help us to know how to respond to that as well. It's in your name we pray, Jesus. Amen. All right. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. All right. Well, we're going to come go and take up a collection for children's ministries here at the church. Anything you can give will be greatly appreciated.
Well, now, if you want to hear that story or the ending of it, that means you're going to have to come next Sabbath to hear it. Because it is a story that hasn't been written yet, right? Anyway, I'm sure you have heard this story before about a $50 bill, a $20 bill, and the $1 bill. They were all in a bank vault, The $50 bill says, man, I've been at every casino, you know, Las Vegas, Atlantic City, Monte Carlo, everywhere. The $20 bill said, I've been almost everywhere in a grocery store and every place you can think of. You know, I've been there. The poor dollar bill looked down, put his head down, and said, me, church. So he only spends his time in the church. We'll have our ushers come forward for our offering and put that lonely dollar in the offering basket. Dear Heavenly Father, we're so thankful that we can make and come to this church this morning to praise your name in so many ways. We want to thank you for the monetary value that you have given us, that we may bring some part of it back to you. May this money go to the place where you think is best and bring more people to your doorsteps. We ask this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Believe that God answers prayer. I do. I believe most of us do that are here. Sometimes we question, Sometimes we wonder. This morning, I was having a little conversation with God about something that I've talked with him about a million times. And I said, Lord, tell me. And he said, the thought came to my mind, I told you. Scripture is filled with promises. And we're told that if we ask, we'll receive. Right? Everything and anything that we bring to God, in knowing that it is his will, there's the hitch. He will give us if we ask. And so this morning, it's time for our prayer, but in fitting with our theme today, I would like to ask for all praises and requests, anyone who has a praise or request you'd like to bring to God, but couch it in the terms of praise. Because if you're asking for it, God's already promised it. He's going to give it to you, right? So when you, I'd like you to just take a second and rethink the way you would present it. Still bring your request, please. Couch it in a praise. Does anyone have praises or requests this morning? Amen. Okay. Amen. 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 Please. Amen. Amen. Praise God. Rosalie. Amen. Go ahead. Sorry. Your name's not coming to my mind right now. I'm sorry, Myra. I'm sorry, Myra. Your name's not coming to my mind. Okay. See, God gave me that right at the right time. Amen. And we are, praise God that in the request is the answer. Cheryl. Amen. Sue. Amen. All right. All right, very good. I invite as many as possible to kneel before the Lord in prayer. Our gracious Heavenly Father, we have kneeled before you this morning in praise. We just thank you so much for all that you've done and all that you are doing and all that you have planned to do that we have not seen yet. We thank you for the jobs that we have and the jobs that you are bringing to us, Lord. We thank you for our church and for each individual here that has come to praise you this morning. We thank you for our family, our immediate family, our extended family, and our church family, Lord. We thank you for every individual that's part of that. Wherever they fit, Lord, they are still part of it, and we praise you for that. We thank you, Lord, for the peace and the confidence that you give us in knowing that you are there with us no matter what we face, Lord. Sometimes we are so distraught because we don't know what's coming. But Lord, if we will just put our faith and trust in you the way you have promised, there's no need to be upset. There's no need to fear because we know that all things work together for our good because we love you and because you love us. We pray and thank you, Lord, that you have already touched the hearts of the judges that are reviewing Myra's case. And we thank you, Lord, that you are strengthening her and that you are giving her the confidence to know that you are always with her no matter what. We thank you for our children, Father, and for the clubs that we have to help lead them to a deeper relationship with you. We thank you for the success in this coming year that is already promised to us. Because you are our God. We thank you for the health and the strength that you give to us every day and the healing that comes through surgery and through our doctor's care and through your touch. We thank you so much for all of this, Lord. And so we praise your name this morning. We lift up our hearts to you and we give our all in honor and glory to your name. We pray in Jesus' precious name. Amen. First Chronicles 16 records a psalm of praise written again by David. And beginning with verse 23, it says, "Sing to the Lord, all the earth. Proclaim the good news of his salvation from day to day. Declare his glory among the nations, his wonders among all peoples. For the Lord is great and greatly to be praised. He is also to be feared above all gods. For all the gods of the people are idols, but the Lord made the heavens. Honor and majesty are before him. Strength and gladness are in his place. Give to the Lord, O kindreds of the peoples. Give to the Lord glory and strength." Amen. And Bob's going to lead us now in a service of praise to our God.
Okay, and now we've heard Mike. Everybody can go home. I mean, he expressed the feelings of what we have today. I don't know how many of you remember William and Robin Williams in that movie, Good Morning Vietnam. He had a very hard task every morning to get up there in the middle of the battlefields and to cheer the troops on with his comments and with his upbeat that he was. So this morning, I would like to have the whole congregation do the same thing and say good morning to our Savior. Now, as the children of God and the Chesterland Church, how about if we say, good morning, Jesus. Good morning, Jesus. Now I know we look around, well, he's not here. But what did he say when he said in John 14, 16, he said, I cannot be with you, but he said, I'm going to send you a comforter. And, you know, there's so many things that are called comfort. You know, a comforter in the wintertime, you snuggle up and then a comfort food, you know, a comfortable chair and all those kind of things. But there's one thing that is specific that God promised us is a comforter to make us feel comfortable all the time. This world is so full of worries that, you know, we need something that will comfort us daily. And I'm so thankful that God promised us that one comforter. So he's here today. You know, you can't see him, but believe me, you can feel him. Now, when I ask, I don't know what made me do it, but when I ask Mike, you know, if I can have this Sabbath, I said to myself, if I could preach like Billy Graham or Nelson or any even as good as Mike, you know, what could I tell you today that you have not heard 1,000 times already? So I said, you know what, let's try something not new, but something that goes way back to Genesis 3:5. Would somebody like to read that? Genesis 3:5. I mean, I can misquote it, but I'd rather if somebody would read it out loud. Remember now, today is your Sabbath. You are going to participate in the program. There's nobody going to be up here. I'm going to sit down and just be quiet. But everybody is going to participate. Each one of you is going to be in this program of praising God. So does somebody have that verse? All right, Sue, I see you're knocking, you know, can you read it? Whoa. This time we're going to do something different so that everybody can hear it.
For God knows that in the day you eat of it, your eyes will be opened, and you will be like God, knowing good and evil.
That's not the verse that I like. Anyway, all right, it was a good verse, but maybe I God came down into the garden, and he says, what did he do? He walked with Adam and Eve. So just imagine yourself, all right, you're fully dressed, so just imagine yourself that you are in the Garden of Eden right now, and Christ is walking with you. So when I give you this mic, not the one that's sitting there, when I give you the mic, I want you to, when we have this, where the congregation can express, you know, a thanks, or maybe tell us how you found Christ. So I'll give you an example. When I was 16 years old, and I was in Germany, I was in the baptismal class. There were six of us in the class. And that poor preacher, I feel sorry for him because he spent 9 weeks with us, you know, teaching us and trying to convince us and shape us into to the place of where we can say, wow, I'm ready to get baptized. Well, the 9 weeks went passed by, And the other five guys were, well, there was girls too. They all said, well, I think I'm ready. And I said, I'm not. I didn't feel like there was, you know, that I was ready to get baptized. But I didn't want to disappoint my mother because everybody was already baptized in our family. So I said, okay, I'll go. Maybe I'll have that moment, you know, when I can say, wow, I got it. So I asked the pastor, can I be the last one? And then I said, ooh, that was a mistake. Because through the whole thing, I was worried, is he going to be able to pull me out of that water before I, you know, swallow enough water? And so anyway, I got up there. My turn came. He submerged me in the water. I came up. Nothing. The only thing I felt was wet. I was soaked. But there was no that wow feeling. It took 6 years and took the United States Army to teach, to actually have me meet Christ. That's maybe a story for some other time. But what happened is the doors were opening in the while I was in the Army constantly, and this was during the height of the Vietnam War. Johnson got in the office, you know, got 200,000 people to Vietnam, and we were, and I was down at basic training, praying almost on a daily basis, you know, that somehow, you know, I can avoid that, you know, the dreaded time when they said, okay, you're going to be shipped over. Well, our orders came, and it says that we were going to be shipped to Germany first. And then from there, I was in the medics, so they were going to ship us over to Vietnam. And, of course, the Vietnamese, they didn't care. They shot anybody that moved. They didn't care if you had a Red Cross on it. That was a good target. So I said, oh, my. I really prayed. So the day when we were supposed to be shipped out, our commanding officer said there was a change of plan. All you guys, that our unit, our whole unit was going to be shipped. In other words, we're going to be dismissed and go home and stay in the reserve, in the Army Reserve. So for 2 years, I was in the Army Reserve waiting for that call that never came. So that's the moment when he said that, is that I said, wow, you are real. You are there. And guess what? Every morning now when I get up, I have that wow moment. Because just being alive is great. And now I'm going to sit down and we're going to go with our program.
morning. When I was a young girl, little girl, like about 10 years old, I think, 8 or 10, I would go over to the Willoughby Church at times because I grew up in this congregation, but we were, this church was located in Cleveland at 178th and Euclid. And some of us sitting here today were part of that congregation and that church building and all down there. But then years later in the early 80s, we moved out here, this congregation did. But also Willoughby Church was always over there in Willoughby when I was growing up. And so if it was bad weather or whatever, sometimes we'd pop over to Willoughby. Most often we went over to Cleveland just to be by my dad's mom because she attended the Cleveland Church with us, Grandma Minnie. Yeah. But when my sister, my brother, and I were young and growing up in church, if we were asked to play, you know, our instrument, play the piano or sing or whatever, you know, we always said yes, because my dad would say, you know, you're doing it for the Lord. And so, you know, you say yes. And so sometimes we didn't want to do it or we were nervous to do it, but we did, you know, and it was good learning. But when Bob asked me to come up and would I do something for today, I thought, well, okay, I'll say a poem. And the gist of the story is when I was a little girl, Mrs. Hampton over at the Willoughby Church, she would call me every now and then, call my mom and say, would Martha come to Vesper service this afternoon and do something, say a poem. So I would say, okay, and I memorized all these poems, and I'd go over to Willoughby for Vespers and say these poems, you know. So it was kind of silly. So Bob came up, he said, would you do something? I said, okay, I'll say these poems. So I'm dedicating this poem to Mike and Cheryl, because they got to go down to Kentucky and see that Ark, which I want to go see. And the title of the poem is Sonnet of a Rainbow by Charlotte Carpenter. The thunderstorm has come and gone, and trees are dripping wet with rain. The sun in the west is sinking low, for ah, the day is dying again. But lo, look toward the east and see the arch of the rainbow in the sky, with violet that makes one think of bravery, courage, and strength. The shining yellow brings to mind the glory of God, just and kind. The red and green, orange and blue, bring other thoughts so kind and true. So as life's stormy paths you trod, think on the rainbow and of God.
When was the last time? I know I have a big mouth, but wow. There's another wow moment. I totally forgot. I want to thank you for so many of you coming today to celebrate and to enjoy Sabbath with our Lord Jesus. I'm so thankful that you're all here. Now we have a testimony. I know everybody has already done this, but you know, if you're hard of hearing like me, anybody that spoke over there or way over there, I couldn't hear it. So this time you're going to speak right into the mic, hold it close like this, and speak into the mic so that everybody can enjoy what you have to say. Any volunteers? Or if you don't volunteer, I'm going to give you the mic. So you better volunteer. Let me see the hand.
Here and then you're not even seeing anybody. My testimony is how I became a Christian. Number one, I was raised a Christian, but a Seventh-day Adventist Christian. I was raised in a Catholic church. I was Catholic until, I can't remember, 1994, and I was 34 years old already. So, yes. So, anyway, I'm trying to make this short, but besides witnesses from the Seventh-day Adventist Church that brought me around to seeing what is biblical truth, I had a neighbor across the street. They were Lutheran. And they came over one day, and they just sat with me, and they asked me, do you think you're going to go to heaven? And I said, I don't know. And they said, if you believe in Jesus Christ, you are guaranteed to go to heaven. Yes, we're plagued by Satan and everything, but if you believe in Jesus and the resurrection, you have a place in heaven. And I had never looked at it that way, and now I'm looking at it ever since, and it's just a powerful blessing.
Thank you, Pam. That is the simplicity of Christianity. Very simple. Accept Christ as your Savior, and that's it. I mean, we do a lot of philosophizing, you know, trying to explain some of these things. Sorry, Mike. You know, when the preachers come up here and they tell us all these things, religion is simple. Accept Christ as your personal Savior, and that's it.
Hold it in front of you, okay? I'm holding it. I just want to say, I was 21 when I got baptized. But before that, we were in concentration camp for 5 years. When I came out, I had no interest anymore in anything. So I got a beautiful job. I worked in an office, and I felt, woo-hoo, I made it. But my mom was constantly, you know, like a chicken picking on me. Come on, let's go to Sabbath, let's go to church. And I would always say, not this Saturday, maybe next, not this Saturday. And I would go to work. And it took me quite a few years until one day I said, okay, I go with you. And I went. And I sat next to a little lady, old like me probably now. And we got up to sing. And that lady sung so beautiful from way down there. And that made my heart tremble. And I said, if she could praise God in that age, what am I waiting for? And that's when I gave my heart to God. Okay.
This song has, I discovered it on YouTube by the SDA Fountain View Academy. If you ever have a chance to listen to them, it's a fabulous group. And I just hope it can bless you as much as it has blessed me.
Fastened tight at the jail that night, so Paul and Silas would not be dismayed. They said, it's time to lift our voice, sing praises to the Lord. Let's prove that we can trust him, come what may. God wants to hear you sing when the waves are crashing around you, when the fiery darts surround you, when despair is all you see. God wants to hear your voice when the wisest man has spoken and says your circumstance is as hopeless as can be. To hear On our cheerful days, when the pleasant times outweigh the bad by far. But when suffering comes along, yet we still sing him these songs. Now that is when we bless the Father's heart. God wants to hear you sing. When the waves are crashing round you, when the fiery darts surround you, when despair is all you see, God wants to hear your voice. When the wisest man has spoken and says your circumstance is as hopeless as can be, to hear you sing. God wants to hear you sing. When the waves are crashing round you, when the fiery darts surround you, when despair is all you see, He wants to hear your voice. When the wisest man has spoken and says your servant hopeless as can be. That's when God wants to hear you sing. Trust Him and sing.
Song for me. Actually, I've been singing that song for the past few months about 6 or 7 times a day. I think Joe maybe told me, okay, that's enough. But it has carried me through not just the words. I mean, can you imagine being in jail and singing? I'm going to need some help singing. Vita, Martha, we skipped over the, come to the garden? Burdens are lifted at Calvary. And we're going to sing that noun 476, or the words are on the screen.
Days are filled with sorrow.
Oh, this is a song that should really humble all of us. No matter how old you are, 100 years old, as my grandmother used to tell us, you're still wet behind the ears as far as the Lord's concerned. As God's children, let's sing Jesus Loves Me with that childlike faith.
Loves me, this I know, for the Bible tells me so. Little ones to him belong, they are weak, but he is strong. Yes, Jesus loves me. Yes, Jesus loves me. Jesus loves me, he who died, heaven's gate to open wide. He will wash away my sin. Let his little child come in. Yes, yes, Jesus loves me. Yes, Jesus, take this heart of mine, make it pure and wholly thine. On the cross you died for me, I will love and live for thee. Yes, Jesus loves me. Yes, Jesus loves me.
All right, let me see any hands here. Anybody that wants to tell us how you met Jesus or why you're thankful for him and what he has done for you? Don't be shy.
As we were singing that song, I was about 3 or 4 years old. That song was the first song I ever learned. Jesus loves me, yes I know. And how I became, I guess, a Christian, because my mother and my family were Christians. And Doug Batchelor, I guess y'all heard of him, and that's how I became a Seventh-day Adventist, because I happened to be looking at TV back in the 90s, and his program came on. And so I started looking at that, and then I sent off for some of his programming, and then I started studying it. And I would study it and do the tests and send it back to him. And then finally I wrote and asked about the churches. And then my niece, who got married here in this church, and I started studying it, and then she didn't know that I was studying, and she seen some of the programs. She said, oh, you studying this? I said, yeah. And then she told me about this church. And that's how I came about coming and studying and with Brother Reed and his wife. And I came out here because I was looking for a church. And that's how it all came about, because I was going to church. I had been baptized in another church. And then I just fell in love out here in Chesterton, and through prayer and everything, and you can't pull me away. And I got baptized here with Pastor Mark in Lake Erie. And I think it was in 2002, I think, something like that. Yeah. And that's how it came about. And it's been beautiful for me. So God bless. That's it. Thank you.
We're all adopted by Jesus anyway, so it makes us an adopted family.
I was raised as a Baptist, and when I was 12 years old, it was like my grandfather was a Baptist minister, and so I'm always listening to him. And one day, it was like a Wednesday, we was getting ready to go to prayer meeting. And I told him, I said, Papa, I think I want to join a church. And he said, why? I said, something came over me today and told me that I needed to get into the church. And so I was raised there, and I stayed there in the church until I was, at the time, I had gotten married young, and our pastor's wife told us about a tent effort going on Woodland, and it was down the street from us. Elder C.D. Brooks was preaching and running a tent effort. And so we started, my husband and I, we both started going to the church and the tent efforts. And so when I was 19, I joined Glenville Seventh-day Adventist Church. And I've been in church ever since. And in the 70s, we built Southeast Church Lee Road. And I moved out to Portage County, and I've joined the Ravenna Adventist Church. And if I stayed in a church, I mean, being young, you did in and out different things. But my heart was always in the church. And I've known all my life that Christ has been there for me through all my illness, through all my troubles. And he's still with me, you know, and at my age, I would never, ever say that there's no Christ. Jesus did not die for me.
I'm warning you people, I'm just going to stick that mic in front of you.
Oh, you're giving me the mic? All right.
We all have a story.
I have a story. It's not a how I came to church story. My story is a little bit different. This is interesting timing, actually. So I was here in this church. I was a teenager at the time. And somebody from this church would pick me up from home in Shaker and would bring me here. And we were working on vacation Bible school stuff. And it was during these times that I was coming to this church that I was doing counseling with Pastor Mark. And that counseling directly led to my being baptized. I was actually baptized in Lake Erie, the same day as Elise. That person who picked me up from home and brought me here every day when I was a teenager was Sherry Hallbank. And to this day, I'm not sure if she ever knew the role she played in bringing me here.
Thank you. Let me see those hands. Come on, folks. Like I said, I'm going to... Notice how he avoids looking at me. Okay, I don't want to embarrass anybody, but then anybody else that would like to say a praise or a thank you or how you met Christ?
Well, I thank God for everything that he brought me back in again. Amen.
Doesn't have to be a big long story, just a short.
It is a long story.
I'm going to bug this side over here. Just grab the mic.
Glad to be here.
Don't worry. I know you have something to say. You always have something to say, something good.
I don't know if I'm going to be able to talk, though. That's the only thing.
Well, I loved church when I was little. And when I got older, I just got away from it. And I ran into a few things, got angry about a lot of things, and just gave up on going to church at all. And you won't believe this, but I was listening to Glenn Beck, which I know he's off the wall. But he kept saying that everybody should go back to their church. I guess the Holy Spirit was working on me too, and he told me, you know, in my heart, I wanted to go back, and I'm glad I came back, because I'm glad God took me back as an old lady.
All right, thank you. I have a big thank you. Right here, the whole role is taken up by my family. I thank God for that. And I'm embarrassing my son-in-law, but that's okay. Anybody else? Ron, I'm going to pick on you.
Well, let the Lord give me the strength. I just want to thank my parents for raising me Adventist. I miss my dad.
All right, now we're going to have a special instrumental you all ready?
Happy Sabbath. Yeah. Good to see you guys too. Good to see you as well. Everyone's always so happy. This is a beautiful day. The testimonies are beyond moving. And, you know, I've learned some things today that I didn't know in the past. But one thing I do know is that God's blessed my life with music and given me the capacity and capability to play instruments, which is one of the greatest joys to be able to use that to praise him back, which we're going to play a song called Jesus, Name Above All Names, which y'all know, and it's actually Mara who picked this song to play and just asked me to accompany her. So that's another side of this blessing of music that God has given us, that I got to see my family grow in music. People who were not born when I came to this country are now surpassing me in all kinds of ways. So I hope you enjoy and are blessed. Sorry, that's the price of playing stringed instruments. You have to tune a lot.
My goodness, and I remember when she was tugging on my coat. Hey, Candyman, can I have a lollipop? And look at her now.
Sabbath, Trish. I'm going to read from the book of Exodus, chapter 33, verse 14 and 15. And it says, "The Lord replied, 'My presence will go with you, and I will give you rest.' Then Moses said to him, 'If your presence does not go with us, do not send us from here.'" We're going to sing a song in Swahili that's based on that verse, actually, that says, "May your presence go with us."
To
Tunaomba uwepo wako uende nasi. Ewe Bwana wa majeshi utusikie. Kama huendi nasi, hatutaki kutoka hapa. Hatuwezi peke yetu, enda nasi. Tuwatua shinga nguvu tusamehe. Hatufai mbele zako turehemu. Tusafishe Baba, tuonyeshe uso wako. Twahitaji neema yako, enda nasi. Tutavua mapambo yetu, vitu vyote vya thamani kwetu. Mioyo yetu twaleta mbele zako, tutakase na utembee nasi. Tunaomba tuonyeshe njia zako, kwa maana umetuita kwa jina lako. Twalilia e Bwana, utukufu na uso wako. Bila wewe tutashindwa, enda nasi. Tutavua mapambo yetu, vitu vyote vya thamani kwetu. Mioyo yetu twaleta mbele zako, tutakase na utembee nasi. Tutavua mapambo yetu, vitu vyote vya thamani kwetu. Mioyo yetu twaleta mbele zako, tutakase na utembee nasi. Mioyo yetu twaleta mbele zako, tutakase na utembee nasi.
Did you enjoy that one? Oh, man. You know, the Bible teaches us not to be envious. But I'm sorry, I am. All these instruments, and I play nothing. Oh, that's a juice harp. You know, anybody can blow into it. But anyway, I really enjoy this. Now we're going to have the whole congregation again sing.
Okay. Anytime we're praising the Lord, this song would come to mind. How great thou art.
Lanise asked me, she said, are we singing all four verses? And I said, you know, it's like reading the first five pages of a book, and then you go and read the last 10 pages. You got to read the whole book. And the artist had something to say in every song. I used to hate that one, just to sing first verse and last verse. Then what about the one in between? Does it matter? Any testimonies? All right. I'm not going to force anybody, but I'm sure that let's all in unison say, thank you, Jesus. Everybody participated that way. Thank you. Mary? Mary?
Explanation, please. Now, it's very unusual for Mary to have made a commitment and not make it. And so we should just have a brief word of prayer, just asking God to care for her and make sure that she's in his arms, which we know he is anyway, okay? Let's bow our heads. Father, we are thankful for all that you're doing for us this morning and this opportunity to praise you. And we just thank you, Lord, that you are caring for Mary. Whatever the reason is she's not here, you are in control. And we just thank you, Lord, that she is in your care and in your protection. So bless us and accept our praise, as humble as it may be. We pray in Jesus' name.
Amen. All right. Now, where are the bells? Oh, here they are.
In sin, but Jesus took me in, and then a little light from heaven filled my soul. It bathed my heart in love and wrote my name above, and just a little talk with Jesus made me whole.
Now let us
have a little talk with Jesus.
Let us
tell him our troubles.
He will
hear our faintest cry,
and he will
answer by and by.
Now when you
feel a little prayer will turning,
and you
know a little fire is burning,
you will find
a little talk with Jesus makes it brighter, makes it right. Sometimes my path seems drear without a ray of cheer, and then a cloud of doubt behind the light of day. The mists of sin may rise and hide the starry skies, but just a little talk with Jesus clears the way.
Now let us
have a little talk with Jesus.
Let us
tell him about our troubles. Hear our faintest cry,
and he will
answer by and by.
Now when you
feel a little prayer will turn
in, and you
know a little fire is burning,
you will
find a little talk with Jesus makes it right, and makes it right.
I may have doubts and fears,
my eyes be filled with tears, but Jesus is a friend who watches day and night. have a little talk with Jesus.
Let us
tell him about our troubles.
He will
hear our faintest cry,
and he will
answer by and by.
Now, when you
feel a little prayer will turn in,
you will
know a little fire is burning.
You will
find a little talk with Jesus makes it right.
Good afternoon, church. I'm having a good time. How about you? All I did was ask Bob for a piece of candy. I didn't know he was going to get me to do this. I asked him what this was all about and whatnot, and he asked me if I had a testimony that I could give it. And being that I was a policeman for 32 years, he said that I would have a lot of stories. And I do. But how about, I'm just going to say that, and this is why I picked this song. After all those years and seeing all those people and their problems and trying to help people out, one thing that we all need is that people need the Lord. Amen. And that's the name of my song this morning.
Every day they pass me by, I can see it in their eyes. Empty people filled with care, going who knows where. On they go through private pain, laughter hides their silent cries. Only Jesus hears. People need the Lord.
You can sing it with me.
People need the Lord. At the end of a broken dream, open door. People need the Lord. People need the Lord. We realize people need the Lord. His light to a world where wrong seems right. What could be too great a cost for sharing life with one who's lost, who is his love.
Sing it with me, come on.
People need the Lord. At the end of broken dreams. He's the open
How many have really enjoyed so far? Amen. Now I twisted the arms of my sister to read the Psalm 23. Oh, you want to come up front? Everybody wants the spotlight.
It's okay. Before I read, I would like to say thank you to my brother. That was beautiful. I mean, we had a free entertainment. What do you want? So, anyhow, it says here, the Lord is my shepherd. He shall not want. He makes me to lie down in green pasture. He leads me beside the still water. He restores my soul. He leads me in the path of righteousness for his name's sake. Can we all say that? Amen. Yes, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for you are with me, your rod and your staff, thy comfort me. You prepare the table for me in the presence of my enemy. You anoint me my head with oil. My cup runs over. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. Amen. Sorry about my voice, but there is a problem.
Thank you. tells me of the years that went before me, when heavenly plans were made for me to be, when all was but a dream of dim conception, to come to life, earth's verdant glory see. When all was but a dream of dim conception, to come to life, earth's verdant glory see. My dad, just as good friends do, this earth will pass, and with it come in trifles, but God and I will go unendingly. This earth will pass, and with it come in trifles, but God and I will go unendingly. This earth will pass, and with it come in trifles, but God and I will go unendingly.
You know, even when we make a little mistake, God doesn't hear it that way at all. He's perfect. So whatever he hears from us, if it comes from the heart, it sounds perfect to him. So I would like you to give a hand, not to us that gave our thanks through our songs, poems, but give a hand to Jesus. Now that you have spiritual food, I'm going to invite every one of you to go in the back and take a seat. And there's all kinds of goodies for you. You can put on a few pounds. Nobody will know the difference. Thank you for coming. I'm sorry?
Wasn't there a last song?
Who?
A last song.
Closing song. Oh, we have a closing song? I didn't know. Sorry. I'm so glad that everybody is so forgiving here.
Let's all stand to sing, Lord, I'm coming home.
I wonder.
As a benediction, the Apostle Paul said, "Let us therefore come boldly to the throne of grace, that we may obtain mercy and find grace to help in time of need." And then John wrote, "This is the assurance that we have in approaching God, that if we ask anything according to his will, he hears us. And if we know that he hears us, whatever we ask, we know that we have what we asked of him." May the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ be with us all. Amen. Let's also have a brief prayer for the meal. Thank you, Lord, and we praise you again and always. Bless our time together after this meeting. Bless our food and our fellowship for your glory and honor. I pray in Jesus' name. Amen.